rise and pledge the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic which stands one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Would you call the roll, please?
Vice Mayor Stanley.
Here.
Commissioner White.
Here.
Commissioner Orthwell.
Here.
Mayor Moore.
Here.
Let the record show that the town manager is Greg Dunham, who's also present, and the staff attorney, Edward Nazaro, police chief, Edward Allen, and myself.
Very good, thank you.
Absent is Paul Lyons.
Oh, yes, indeed. Mr. Lyons is not here with notes.
Yeah.
We've been provided with the minutes from our last meeting on August 9th. Are there any corrections, additions, changes? If not, is there a motion to approve?
Motion to approve the minutes from the last meeting, August 9th, 2019.
Second.
Ms. Tillman.
Vice Mayor Stanley.
Yes.
Commissioner White.
Yes.
Commissioner Orthwell.
Yes.
Mayor Morgan.
Yes. Okay, we have a withdrawal today. The Board of Adjustment hearing has been withdrawn. We'll be proceeding after directly to reports. Next meeting, actually our next meeting is the tentative budget meeting this afternoon at 5:01. Our next regular commission meeting will be October 11th at 9 a.m. Are there any public comments? If not, let's move on down to 9, the town manager's report on underground.
Thank you, Mayor. So, with respect to Comcast, they actually today did what they call optimized half of the equipment that they have most recently installed. What that means is they turn it on and activate the system to see if it's working. And so they got half of it activated today, and then they got it rain on, and so they're going to finish activating it on Monday or Tuesday, depending on the weather. And so, you know, to my knowledge, I think everything was working okay with the first half of it. And so once they check that all out, then they will begin to do fiber drops at the 99 homes that actually are signed up to Comcast cable. And so they will, so they're just literally putting in the conduit and the lines up to the houses. And so they could really actually start on that next week if scheduled. So what they'll do is they'll go street by street. I mean, they won't do a house here and a house there, and that, so they'll go street by street to try to you know, finish a street. And then as soon as that they've done that, then the on that street, then the residents can then make appointments to, they have to come out and they have to make sure all that's working, and then they've got to go inside and work on the cable boxes and that for a short period of time. So it's kind of the light at the end of the tunnel.
Yeah,
there.
Sounds good. Flickering, but
that's right.
That is it.
And when they go inside, they, you know, then you need to make sure the modem and cable boxes are working and that sort of thing. So that's why they have to have good ones. AT&T, they still have two or three bores that they have to do, and the reason is because the conduit is too deep for them. When they do their splicing, they dig a hole when the guys get down into it. And so the conduit is too deep, so they're just replacing it. Not at our expense. But they have about three of those. One of them is 200 feet on the way. So I'm not exactly sure where that 200 feet is, but so they'll, those are scheduled, those bores are scheduled for next week. And so, but they are, you know, pretty much done with their splicing. But these areas that they need to bore, they will still have to do the splicing. There's an area out here on A1A around the school that they have to do some major one is from, you know, the, our alleyway, basically, from between Gulfstream and Polo. That would bury it too far, so they have to do a bore from Gulfview to down the Banyan. But all these are scheduled to start next week. Let's see, yeah, so that, I mean, that's, I see that as good news.
Yeah, no, the scheduling of those bores sounds great, they seem to, Comcast sounds like they're almost finished.
Yeah, so, it's the, what, the best thing about all this is that they ended up working simultaneously, because they swore they would not do that. So we were very pleased about that.
Any questions on the underground? If not, thank you.
I have a question, may I?
Of course you can.
Okay, this is the 74th time I've asked this question. But if you will recall.
Yeah.
When that guy came in here and after that and after that, I'm still sitting with about a mile of pipe against my wall that they say they are going to put the cable in the pipe as opposed to just lying on the ground and bring it to my house. And I want to make damn sure that they don't say, well, we're finished.
No, he knows about it. I keep reminding him.
Thank you.
And so he says they're not, he knows about it. They won't be finished until they do that.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, mine is laying out in the woods too.
I'll let you
tell me they couldn't do anything about it.
Is it on top of the ground?
Oh yeah, it just runs right across the ground. But it would be awfully, if they were to do it on my property, it would not be as difficult.
Well, there are parts that.
That was a phase one.
That was phase one, yes. And when phase one ended, they said, we'll come right back. And they never did.
Okay.
And you know, quite frankly, it just, it burns me.
Yeah, I could see why you would be concerned about that.
Well, I mean, I've tripped over it half a dozen times. Yeah. I've got a big garbage bag full of leaves or something like that. And it's just lying there.
Do we have something, put something in writing to them about that?
Sure. I will. I think he knew about it back, what was it, 6 months ago when we met? And he has told me, I'm going to fix that when we finish phase two.
Thank you.
But I mean, I can do that. I'm sure.
It seems like a separate thing from what they're doing in phase two. That's just
Because you're phase one, so.
Right. Anyways, let's let's make sure we record that. Thanks for bringing that to our attention.
And I can't quite keep from hitting mine with a weed eater, so the part of mine that's above the ground. So So the Place Isolay street lighting. If you recall, I mean, where we left this after the last meeting, Ms. White. And FPNL came and made a very good presentation to us, and I think Ms. White and Mr. Snavely went out and looked at some areas that they had identified, you know, that had these lights. And I think you guys had really come to the conclusion that you liked the black. Right.
Because the greens the green was, even the top, the lighting fixture itself, it was a lighter green. Not as deep as the one on the street signs, but the poles, the mottled appearance of the poles wasn't attractive together.
And as you recall, we talked about the costs, and I think the commission is good with the cost. I mean, we're very surprised about the costs, and so I think you're good with that. So it's a matter now of just ordering them if the commission is ready to do that. Place Isolay is ready to do that. Now, here's the thing. If you remember, you know, it's the lighting, the LED lighting. And so they have two different levels, and I think you've made the comment that you would prefer the
5,000, I think.
But yeah, you would prefer the higher level.
I'm not really sure.
Okay, so we can we can have them go out and install one light, and you know, kind of like we did over here. I think we did kind of a test for several weeks, or maybe it was months, with the two strengths and the limits. If that's what you'd like to do, but it, I mean,
it would probably be a good idea if they could do that. You know, I know for a while Chuck was concerned about the present street lights interfering with the underground lighting under the private streets.
Right.
And so.
Well, yes, and he approached me about that street light right there as you first come in, right on the corner by LaVoy's house. I mean, it's an important street light right
now,
there.
My issue was safety before aesthetics there, because, you know, but I walk my dogs at night, other people walk their dogs at night, or take, you know, I mean, just.
Yeah, because I mean, it lights up that intersection, which
needs some light.
You know, there's a street you can't go, you know, down. We've got the signs, but I mean, if it's not lit up, I mean, so.
Maybe I don't know really what the 3,000 would look like.
Yeah,
as opposed to 5,000.
Well, why don't we proceed like that? I mean, we can do that if your preference.
Well, we can authorize the.
Yeah, to start to order the product.
Ordering of the lights with a test period of time on one of the light bulbs for the lower and the higher lumen.
Is it the same? Is it the same same fixture? They just set it differently, or do you have to order it specific? I don't remember from the presentation.
I think you have to order it.
Yeah,
they didn't do. That's what I remember.
Right.
It was.
You had to choose.
Oh yeah, they had choices. There were choices.
Yeah,
so
you got to, once they order it, then.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, how difficult is it to change out the?
Oh no, that's.
It's not.
No, it's not difficult, and they would do it. I mean, with these out here, we own these things, and so we have to do all that. These are FPNL lights, so.
But these you could dim, I think, from what I remember.
These out here you can.
But the ones over here.
They have two different levels, right.
But didn't they say they could put some frost shielding or frosting
shield
or something?
The, yes, they
the
can
shield
do
on the back so it doesn't go into the house. But I gather they could do some kind of frosting or something.
Yeah, they can do that, but you know what? You're basically not gonna know what you need to do until you get them out there and people react to them.
Now, how many lights is it?
26.
So it's 26 street lights, and it was the black.
Black.
Both the.
Both the pole and the.
Pole and
right.
The fixture. And the fixture.
Do you have different places in Plaza Soleil that you want 5,000 and different places you want 3,000? Like at the entrance, they have that entrance. I'm just saying,
right.
Because they have that entrance,
sure.
That we don't have an entrance like that. If to light up the entrance to have more visibility to, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Oh, sure. And I think FNL, especially the people that I work with, will be very flexible about that.
Yeah.
They'll let us.
It might be something if you're worried about lighting coming into and that an intersection where nobody's going to be, you know,
right.
Affected.
Yeah, so we could. You know, your board could evaluate this, talk to the residents, and say we want, you know, these six to be the higher. And, you know, these.
But honestly, I mean, the real test of that is going to be once we put them up.
Yeah, I agree with that.
All right. Well, is there a motion to approve the purchase of the 26 streetlights?
The lease, isn't it?
I'm sorry.
It's the lease.
The lease through FPNL. Okay.
Yeah, I'll move to. Unless you want to do this.
Okay, I'll move to approve the 10-year lease for the new streetlights for Plaza Soleil, as indicated at Granville.
Oh gosh, I don't have the folder, so
yeah,
I don't know.
Back.
But
it's a Granville, I think. It's a
yes. Picture. Okay.
In black.
In black color.
In black color.
I'll second that.
And with a test period.
Yeah.
For the lumens. Ms. Taylor.
Vice Mayor Stanley.
Yes.
Commissioner White.
Yes.
Commissioner Orthwine.
Yes.
Mayor Ward.
Yes. And moving on to the hurricane report.
Okay, yes, I just wanted to report back on the hurricane. I guess it's Dorian, and so the chief can help me out on this, but we never at any time during the hurricane called in all of our officers at the same time, correct, Chief?
Correct.
And so we weren't on our normal strength. I mean, we maybe, because Ocean Ridge helped on the north side and Delray on the south side, and we do this every time we have a storm like this, and then we have officers out, when we have the evacuation orders. So that's basically why we had to, have extra officers come in to help us do that. But we never had to have this room full of the police officers. And I thought all the towns and cities worked very well together. It can get kind of stressful, especially, and I'll say this, the evacuation order lasted till 3:45 on that Tuesday. And so when we had a conference call with the ELC on Tuesday at noon, they weren't gonna lift that really until the next day. And so we're having to deal with residents, and I'm sure Ocean Ridge the same way, where it's sunny out and they just want to come back in, And so we let our residents in. But it was, they still had the order going, and so it's kind of hard to say, you're not really supposed to be in here, but we'll let you anyway. So we complained during the conference call, and the county thought twice about it, and so lifted the order at 3:45, so everybody was able to get back. But the one thing I do want to say is our Code Red system that we put in worked great. If you guys are...
I agree with that. It did work great.
I mean, it's instantaneous, and thank you to Rebecca for, she's the one that feeds the information to it, and so we used it during that, and then, of course, with the situation that we had, what was it, Monday?
Tuesday.
And so, it's something where you have a limited number of spaces that you can put information on. So you just put the milestones and the important, you just don't get into the weeds of it. And so and that's good. So, speaking of our missing person, I think the chief might, if he could kind of tell you a little bit about, I'd ask him to bring you up to speed on that.
Yeah, if everybody's aware of it or not, but on Tuesday at about 8:49 a.m., we received a call here of a missing person in Place Osceola. The missing person was Robert Dittman. I think everybody probably knows the gentleman, been a resident here for many years. Unfortunately, he suffers from Alzheimer's. He wandered away from the home, and it was actually quite some time before his wife realized he was gone. And we were working with almost a 2-hour delay, and we got the call to find him. We immediately applied a silver alert out through the Code Red system, as well as it went out through NCI, through Delray. We also had a photo of him that went to every police officer in Boynton and Delray and our own as well on our, through your car. We went door to door searching around the backyards of homes in Osceola. We also went to a lot of the businesses along Federal Highway where he might have stopped in, and went in and showed pictures and asked if they had seen him at all. And we did actually have two people that did see him earlier on. It also turned into a multi-agency operation because we had Delray assisting us on the south side, Boyd was working on the north side, and the Palm Beach County Sheriff's Office, who we called in for the assistance of a bloodhound dog to search. They brought their response team in, 5 men from them. They brought a bloodhound in, they searched the whole wooded area north of Osceola. Unfortunately, that came up negative. And they had 2 units in that were flying drones. They flew drones over the whole area. They flew drones from Atlantic Avenue to Woolbright and from Seacrest to the unfortunately, at about a little after 5 p.m., we received a call from Boynton PD, and they located our subject. He was in the backyard of the resident's home, almost to Ocean Avenue in Boynton. Unfortunately, he was in good health, no injuries, no medical issues going on, and so he was reunited with the family. And so it was very nice to have a good joint effort working with the other agencies, and it all worked well. And hopefully we don't have it again.
That was a remarkably well concerted effort by your office and the other local police departments. Did a terrific job. And in that respect, kudos to you and the other police, as well as our staff, during the lead up to the almost storm. It could have been terrible, but we...
Oh, it could have been. I mean, we were nervous about that one, so...
But y'all did a lot of work. Most people don't know it, don't see or hear what you're doing, how you are. You're here all the time, and constantly monitoring the events as they develop. So we're really appreciative of your efforts.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'd also like to thank you from Plaza Solid for all the efforts that the whole team put in. I know it was a lot of hours and a lot of dedication.
I'd like to follow up on the Place House Lay. The gatehouse out there is, we're hoping that it'll be done by the end of next week. That they should have been out there painting today. Did you see them?
I did not.
Okay, well, maybe it won't be done by the end of next week. They got put on 3 doors, the final fixtures for the bathroom, and then they need to build the desk. So, so that's an update on that. Okay, so the next item, if you allow me to read a letter that was sent to me from, or portions of a letter, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but from the Government Finance Officers Association. We are pleased to inform you, based on the examination of your budget document by a panel of independent reviewers, that your budget document has been awarded the Distinguished Budget Presentation Award from the Government Finance Officers Association for the current fiscal period. This award is the highest form of recognition in governmental budgeting. Its attainment represents a significant achievement by your organization. When a Distinguished Budget Presentation Award is granted to an entity, a certificate of recognition for budget presentation is also presented to the individual or department designated as being primarily responsible for its having achieved the award. And so, they did enclose the certificate of recognition for budget preparation to Rebecca Tu, our Chief Financial Officer.
Well, congratulations.
It takes a lot of work. Yeah, she does a great job doing that, so we're proud of that. So I think that ends my report.
Very good. Any questions, comments on anything that the town manager reported on? If not, the ARPV meeting is this month, September 26th at 8:30 a.m. For anyone who wishes to attend. But we go right back to Mr. Dunham for the finance director report.
Okay, so the summary that you have is 11 months of the fiscal year. Rebecca did make some notes in the front of the document for you. Rebecca can help me out a little on this one, but August. So, the expenses that you see there are
today. They're current up to the month. It's 11 months into the year.
Yeah, and so on the revenues, you'll see that we might not necessarily have the revenues that we budgeted, but that's not unusual. And Rebecca, take it away.
Because a lot of those revenues are collected by various entities, within FPL or the state, and it has to pass through several different stages. There's a lag in disbursements, and so typically we get our last disbursements in November. So we still technically have September, October, and November as far as state way it is for everybody. And it's the way that it's been for years, but it does look a little odd, so we just thought we would call it.
We always like to point that out at the end of August. But I think our revenues are still over our expenses even at this point in time.
We are doing very well.
Question, that's it.
Okay, you're looking at the cash and budget report of August 31st, is that the one?
Correct.
Yep. And I appreciate that, you know, spending time with me the other day. The one question, and maybe, I know you said it's with the hurricane and everything, is the water fund, what the liability, what was paid out of the general fund was $142,631, and what was the asset, it was $132,173.
I'm sorry, I'm not following. There was...
Usually it comes in, it's the same number that comes in and out.
So what pages are you on?
Page two.
Page two.
Do you want to say what was due to the water fund?
And I knew that was going to be an odd thing. Because typically what I do is I transfer funds between the water savings account and the general fund operating account. And I also do it to the penny sales tax fund. Those are all separate bank accounts. But this time, because of Dorian, I literally just got pulled away and I couldn't make that adjustment by the end of, and it's kind of a misnomer how those accounts are labeled, because those are the transfer ins and transfer outs from various funds. They're not, since we now have the penny sales tax, that's why they're not even. There's money owed to the penny sales tax fund. So that's why they're not necessarily even. It'll rectify itself on the next one, the next financial statement. I just got distracted with Dorian, I'm sorry.
I'm just using the same number.
But that's why it's different. I'm gonna have to relabel those to make them a little more clear, but that's why it's not the same number.
Good catch.
That's a good catch.
Any other questions on the financial report? If not, Chief?
Request that the approval report be that's been submitted.
We will accept the report as submitted. Let's move on then to ordinance number 19/3. Ms. Taylor.
An ordinance of the Town Commission of the Town of Gulfstream, Palm Beach County, Florida, amending the date of the 2020 municipal election from March the 10th, 2020 to March the 17th, 2020 to coincide with the 2020 presidential primary election, providing a date for qualifying for such election, providing for severability, providing for repeal of ordinances in conflict, providing an effective date. It was passed on first reading the 8th day of August 2019 and is presented for second and final reading on this 13th day of September 2019.
Any comments?
Motion to approve ordinance number 19-3 as presented.
Second.
Ms. Taylor.
Vice Mayor Stanley.
Yes.
Commissioner Hoyt.
Yes.
Commissioner Orthwhite.
Yes.
Mayor Morgan.
Yes. Let's move on to auditor engagement letters.
Okay. You'll see that there's two of them in here from Nolan Holt and Minor. Rebecca, how long have we had them? 25 years.
I would think it'd be 24 years, because next year will be our last year before we have to go out to bid.
Yeah. So if you recall, with waste management, you have, I think it's 30. We had 30 years, right, before we had to go out to bid. It's either 25 or 30.
I think it's 20. Well, for this, I think it's 25.
Yeah. For this, it is.
Yes.
So this is similar to waste management, and so we've had Nolan Holt and Minor for a long period of time, and so this is the last year we can continue our relationship through these engagement letters without going to bid, and so we will be doing that next year. And so these, make sure doing it by engagement letters. There's two of them here, and it's, over the years, one of the longer one, what it, basically the biggest difference is that it sets forth the town's responsibilities as to what we have to provide to the auditors for this process to occur. And then the second one basically sets forth the fact that they will be auditing our records and books to ensure that they meet the Governmental Accounting Standards Board rules. That's GASB rules. And so that's the main difference between these two. In fact, the longer letter actually repeats some of the language in the short.
Any questions on these two engagement letters? Is there a motion to approve the financial audit and government responsibilities engagement letter with Nolan Colton Meyer?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Ms. Taylor?
Vice Mayor Stanley?
Yes.
Commissioner White?
Yes.
Commissioner Orthwhite?
Yes.
Mayor Morgan?
Yes. Is there also a motion to approve the compliance examination engagement of Nolan Colton Meyer?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Ms. Taylor?
Vice Mayor Stanley?
Yes.
Commissioner White?
Yes.
Commissioner Orthwhite?
Yes.
Mayor Morgan?
Yes. Items by commissioners? I have something to discuss. You may recall at the last commission meeting, Representative Caruso spoke to us about the potential for a mandate from the state for septic to sewer transition. And we questioned him a bit on that. I met with him this week to discuss it a little further. Also spoken with Mayor Kaz and some of the commissioners at Ocean Ridge about their concerns on this issue. And I think since we have time today with the withdrawal of the Board of Adjustment hearing portion of our meeting, that we should discuss it. Ocean Ridge has determined that this is something that's going to happen and it needs to be addressed. They have already engaged an engineering firm to put together the scope of work at a budgetary price. They've also engaged a financial firm to give them advice on ways in which they might finance whatever that number is. That number could be very high. I think that Gulfstream should do the same. We had an evaluation of septic done some 20 years ago, and I think that it would be prudent for us to engage and authorize the town manager to engage our engineering firm, Baxter and Woodman, to bring that report from the 90s up to speed, evaluate what it would take to transition the entire town over to sewer and get some budgetary numbers on it. In my conversations with Representative Caruso, he is willing to help us and other local towns within his district approach the state for funding to assist that transition. He stressed that there is a push in Tallahassee to advance this issue faster than most of us thought was what they would be using as a timetable. So he urged us to get on it. So I think we should do that. We have the issue as well of a private sewer in the core that services approximately a third of the core town. That's a private sewer over which we have no responsibility and no involvement. The engineering firm should consider whether that sewer would continue as is or whether it would be brought into a new modern municipally graded sewer that we would take responsibility for, or whether it would be left in the condition that it currently is and taken over by the town as part of our sewer responsibilities. So I throw that all out there to you to just get your thoughts.
Only a third of the core is on that private sewer? I thought more than a quarter.
It's around, I think it's
the bulk of our residents live in the core, but there's only 100 of them. I occasionally will get an updated list. So the last one I think had somewhere around maybe 113 in it.
The problem is, as new homes are developed, and in fact, if significant renovations are done, and they are within a certain distance from the sewer, they must connect to it. And it's really not designed as a municipal sewer in that sense. It's not, wasn't built that way. This will be very expensive. I think the person at Bush at Ocean Ridge used the word disastrously expensive.
It is very expensive to do sewers.
So that's
incredibly
why
to do to a gravity flow from the homeowners, because you're talking a whole different, in fact, I don't even know in the bottom end here if it's possible to do a gravity flow. So, I mean, I'm just,
what?
But that's why you need engineers.
That's right.
And it was astronomical in cost before, and so I don't know, this is first, I mean, I don't know how the state can mandate to put that kind of financial burden on the individual. I just don't see that.
Well, they put it on the town. I think they...
But that's putting it on the town.
Certainly could. Now, it wouldn't be a bad idea to talk at Lake Cities about this and see what their position. The cost of it, could overwhelm any other municipal action by these small towns. And you couldn't do anything else, because all monies would go toward servicing the debt of the sewer. But I think what I think we should do is certainly explore it.
I
don't know how much it will cost to have.
I think we should get a cost factor for exploring it,
yeah,
and then see where Ocean Ridge is too before we spend too much money on this. Because you know how government works, but I just can't imagine they can mandate this. I mean, unless you rebuild or build new houses and you have to hook up to the existing one. But the existing one, they want the town to take over anyway. I mean, I know everybody knows that. I mean, they run it like a private sewer, but it's really going to be the responsibility of the town if something goes wrong with it. I mean, because it's their responsibility, but technically, if an accident happens or backfires, I mean, the town's going to be left cleaning up the mess.
What was the last, was that report that we had when we did the strategic planning? Was that 3 or 4 years ago? 3 years ago, we had a meeting on that. We had the old report. Was that, did that include the water and the sewer in that really old number? In the big engineering report?
Do something to look into the sewer also. It was kind of an aside, because I remember
what I remember looking at, sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt, but I thought it was just, we had a sewer study.
The sewer study, well, I think the number was like really, really high then.
It was.
Wasn't it like 18 million or
Commissioner Orthman said, I mean, the gravity system is much more expensive, but they were big numbers. But I think that was done in 1999.
They were huge numbers. But there was a question whether the gravity pool could even be done in certain parts of the town.
Yes, I think that's true. That's my recollection of conversations with Matthews Engineering at the time. Which makes it just all the more expensive.
The Coastal Star did a very good article in its current edition, and it mentioned, I guess, about Ocean Ridge, where they're doing, and I guess you have the gravity flow and then the vacuum system. And then there are also, from another article, they said there's some woman that even with the septic tanks, there's been a lot of advancement quality of the effluent, I guess is the correct word, that flows out, so that it's not as toxic. So, I mean, there are other options. But as I remember reading with Ocean Ridge, they were talking about some condos that on the mainland side, south of Woolbright, would probably do the gravity flow. flow, and I think they were talking about $2 million for that, for 5 condos there, and that on the mainland it would be $20,000 for the vacuum system, but at least that's how you remember what they were looking at. It's a very interesting explanation that they are some advanced options.
Yeah, well, Ocean Ridge is certainly ahead of the curve on it. Now, whether they're going to proceed by themselves or not, I think, Joan, you're right. We should find out what is the responsibility of the town. Can we be forced, can we be mandated by the state to convert to it? I suspect you could, but it seems maybe we ought to find that out. And the Lake Cities would be the place to go, I think, to at least get some background information and some legal input from it. Certainly nothing wrong with getting an updated cost factor on this, but my point was, should this mandate come through, I would want to join with the other towns impacted by it and use either our representative or the several representatives who cover those districts to approach the state for funding as a group, not as a series of individual towns, small towns. That's kind of the point I was going to make.
I think also you have to know that the new sources, the septic tank systems are incredibly different than the old ones. Because we are on the water, and I'm just using this word because it's northeast and they're so environmental friendly up there, but you still have the septic tanks, but they're built totally different than the old ones around here. So when new construction goes up or like whatever, you go to this new septic tank system that's totally different. I mean,
I do know in Manalapan, when I was there, you know, these big mansions on A1A, they put in these new systems, and they were very expensive.
Yeah, they're very expensive. And they're some above ground, and they have pumps in them. Because just being near the water where we are, when we have to redo ours, it's very expensive and it's very elaborate.
Christine, do you have any information to provide us?
Sure, do I need to I think you're on the right track. I know it's a difficult decision, and it was a can that we kicked for a very long time down the road, and I think we're all in the same situation. We had something that was called Focus 2000. It was done in 1998.
I was there.
Of course you were there. And everybody got together, and they, commissioners, all picked 5, you know, outstanding citizens, and they got together. And the top thing that came out of that was conversion from septic to sewer. So here we are 20 years later, still kind of talking about. One thing that you, the Florida League of Cities and Richard Radcliffe is, at least for our Palm Beach County, is well aware, and we bring it up over and over. Unfortunately, there is such a limited number of municipalities that are dealing with this, mainly coastal, that it hasn't gotten a lot of traction on a statewide level. But I was at a meeting with Congresswoman Frankel about a week and a half ago, and we talked about it. They did a round table, and they asked every municipality what was their biggest concern, what kept them up at night, and we expressed that this was one of them for sure. So I had the opportunity to speak with Congressman Brian Mast. He understands that too. Water is one of his major initiatives, so he's very well aware of it. I think there is a lot to be said for all of us getting together as smaller municipalities in this situation and maybe doing just a joint letter to some of these elected officials just to put it on the radar to make sure that they understand. On October 7th, I think DEP is putting on a seminar or workshop up in Jacksonville as a full day and is talking about conversions from septic to sewer. And so our town manager is going to be attending that. So the other thing that we've done proactively is because we know that it is going to be such a large, long-term, very expensive project, we put together a citizens advisory board to help the staff do some of the heavy lifting. because you're right, there is 10 different septic systems, there's 5 different gravity things, it just goes on and on and on. So we have a 5-member citizens advisory board. They've met twice. Their next meeting is on September 18th, which you, obviously it's a public meeting, everybody is more than welcome to. It's at 8:30 in the morning, and we are going to have our engineer, which is Ingenuity, actually give a state of the union of what she sees are the conditions on within Ocean Ridge, with an eye to our multifamilies, which are all on package plants, and some of them are failing, some of them are chugging along just fine. So that's part of what we, you know, in Mary Kay could speak much better to it from the article.
I'm sorry, I don't want to interrupt. What's a package plant?
It is just a plant that takes care of a multifamily, since 5, 10, 15, 20 units.
Okay, so it's a septic tank, that's what they refer to.
Correct, and some are above ground, some are below ground. Ocean Club is above ground.
Okay.
The one, I think, at Ocean Ridge Yacht Club is below ground, Crown Colony is below ground. But that's really how we got pushed into, you know, finally opening our eyes about this is, you know, our citizens came to us that are in these multifamily situations and said, it is going to be ridiculously expensive to replace the entire thing, even if we are allowed to. Question is, if we're allowed to. So how are we going to work this out? And at first, we had allowed them to go ahead and start to negotiate individually with Boynton, and we've kind of pulled back on that right now. So, and trying to look at it more as a town-wide initiative.
Do you have any sewers up in Ocean Ridge at all?
Nothing. No.
There's nothing leading into anything, are there?
I don't think so. No.
So Ocean Ridge at this point is evaluating, essentially from the top down, a complete transition of the town to possibly just portions of the town.
Correct. We would probably do it in phases, and we may begin with the multifamily, particularly the multifamilies that are failing right now, and start with them. Boynton has made presentations on 2 separate occasions with us, so there's areas of the town that are easier for them to hurry up and serve. One is just south of Woolbright because of the infrastructure that they're putting in across the street at the old Winn-Dixie. So it'd be very easy for them to lay a pipe at the same time as they're bringing stuff in.
So coming near the water.
Correct. They're also talking about eventually a pipe right across from Oceanfront Park, which is right across from our town hall. Their Oceanfront Park system is failing. So, and because they don't generate enough flow, they would need more people to actually bring the pipe through and do it. So, it's interesting. They've got some needs. We've got the need, but not necessarily the short timeline that they have. So it's kind of an exploration and a little bit of a dance right now.
So if you can't get sewers to them that quickly, what are these multifamily residents going to do? Because doing a sewer system isn't like an overnight.
No, it's not. And the good news is there's only really one multifamily that is really having a hard time. The other ones have been able to change some of their equipment, change the people that they're using, and have been, you know, through, you know, bandages and patches, been able to get, you know, another 3 to 5 years out of it, which is basically, like you said, you know, the window of what almost any of it takes. So, but I do like your idea of the barrier island communities pulling together, maybe on just some kind of joint letter to elected officials saying, you know, we're beginning to explore it, but, you know.
What's in 4001?
They're on sewer.
Point and sewer.
I mean, everybody from Sea Road.
Right.
Sea Road Howard is some in the sewer.
And then we're on private, and really this is going to affect the south end of town where the private one
doesn't exist.
Right. So really you're talking where the golf, because it goes to the golf club down to George Bush or Pelican Lane. Those residents are the ones that are going to be affected.
Yep.
Well, yeah. But the private sewer, as I recall Matthew's engineering reporting back, was not a municipal sewer.
Correct.
So it's not, I would
may not qualify for the mandate. Right?
mean, that's questions you're gonna have to, because.
A special exemption.
The sewer comes only to here, and then we take care of all of this, so it's really from the golf club to George Bush. I'm just pointing, you know.
Right, the system, this system here doesn't work for everybody. There's some houses, even new construction on Oleander, that are too far from the lines that actually have new septic tanks.
Interesting, really? They can't put the line in there?
Too far, it's from a certain distance, they can't hook up. So there's, this low flow sewer system can't service everybody here.
How come it went all the way up to the golf club? Remember that?
They ran their own line.
Okay, but then these people could run their own lines too.
Well, the golf club was gonna get shut down if they didn't run the line, so these down, the other ones were approved because they couldn't run it.
Oh, interesting. Well, technically, because it's not a municipal sewer, so technically you don't have to hook up to it. That came up a long time ago too.
No, I mean, you have to hook up to it.
If it comes along.
But I meant, it's not a municipal grade sewer.
Right, but if you're too far, the new houses in town, like a Oleander, it's too far and they're not making them run, I'm just saying they're not making them run the line like a golf club chose to do.
Right, you're not directionally bore. The homeowner does not require to directionally bore 200 feet to hook into under public streets.
Yeah, that's because it's not municipal.
And Greg, you're planning on attending the Ocean Ridge meeting next week.
Right.
Christine, do you have any idea when you will be getting a report back from Ingenuity?
They're gonna make a verbal report on the 18th, and I don't know when the written report is.
Okay, so they're that far along that they can report back on budgetary numbers and general scope of work?
General scope, I'm not sure that they're gonna go into the budgetary. We actually hired a separate organization, Rafatellis, to do the financial planning side of it. But we first have to determine what we want to do, if are we going to do it in phases, when we're going to do it, and then the back end will be coming. But we've heard anywhere from $25 to $45 million.
Yeah. I think an engineering report is probably the place to start, because this is an old system too. I don't know how long they last.
25, 30 years old.
30 years
at least.
Yeah, at least 30.
I remember when they had the first initial. It really was because of the houses down here on Old School Road, because their septic tanks just, the water was so, before we put these pumps in, these houses probably wouldn't even be here. It's so low. Honestly, I live down here. 30 years ago, I couldn't even drive in my driveway when it rained. I had to wait for low tide.
Before dawn.
Okay.
Well, I did speak to Baxter Whitman today to put together a proposal just to, you know, to update.
Update our report.
Yeah.
Okay. And I think we're all in agreement.
Yeah, totally.
Okay. Good. And we'll report back next meeting. Okay. Any other comments? Okay, this meeting is adjourned.